always challenging to react on a text one mostly agrees with. However, this confession of mine should not be taken as the strategy of captatio benevolentia, that is to capture the goodwill of the author and the audience. The reason why I approach Falk's thesis about crossing the Rubicon with sympathy lies in my conviction that it presents much needed interruption of the Czech debate on the relations between philosophy and theology, which is, in my opinion, somewhat fossilized and sterile. And perhaps I should say that I speak here from the perspective of a theologian. I'm perhaps the only theologian who claims to be a theologian here among the speakers. So when I criticize that this discussion between theology and philosophy is a bit underdeveloped, I say it as a criticism of my own domain, theology. I do not aim to attack philosophers with this charge. But nevertheless, both philosophers and theologians live in and protect their distinctive fiefdoms, and both theologians and philosophers seem to be happy and quite satisfied with the present state of affairs, at least in this country. Although, for example, László Tengely emphasizes that phenomenology made possible a radically renewed sense of theology, and Jean-Yves Lacoste claims that the distinction between two disciplines is artificial, caused by the modern university, and argues that philosophy and theology are united in their common task of thinking. The situation, as I have already mentioned, at this university and this country is still perhaps accurately captured in the words of the most significant Czech phenomenologist, Jan Patočka, who makes clear that, now I quote, "The philosopher knows that he must eternally walk on earth," or even more resolutely, and I quote from Patočka's essay, Theology and Philosophy again, "The philosopher never helps the theologian," end quote. In other words, it seems that Jeannicot's critique of the so-called theological term in French phenomenology as an irregular development violating the basic principles of phenomenology as rigorous science is widely held position. But don't get me wrong, the point of this observation is not about charging philosophers from the perspective of a theologian. In fact, as I've already mentioned, it is mostly theologians who would applaud to Jeannicot's thesis that theology and philosophy make two fondeurs. Indeed, Geoffrey Bleschel's claim that phenomenology presents itself as new ancilla theologia is mostly disregarded as a scandalous statement. Now, when we have been reminded about Jeannicot's undermining of the idea of reciprocal reliance between phenomenology and theology, let me move to some Falk's crossings which offer an alternative perspective. And I will address three sets of questions to Professor Falk. First, I would like to turn attention to the distinction between philosophy of religion and philosophy of religious experience. The former, as we have already heard, is an exclusively philosophical perspective, remaining methodologically pure regarding the object of examination, religion. The latter approach, philosophy of religious experience, follows, for example, Augustine, Kierkegaard, Edith Stein, and perhaps even the early Heidegger, in order to elucidate their respective lived experiences in relation to their faith decisions and allegiance. The point of this distinction, however, is not to baptize philosophy. The philosophers of the religious experience, to recall the words of Jan Patočka once again, remain walking on earth. Or, as Falk stresses, their inquiry delves into the depths of the human per se, that is, a theory of lived experience and the way of life. This brings me back to Jeannicot's critique of the theological term. He accuses its representatives of excessive introducing the unapparent, that is, something received from the domain of faith, into philosophical discussion. On the one hand, it is clear that Falk makes clear that no phenomenology is faithless, because there is always the primordial faith in the world. Yet, the question I want to raise and address to Professor Falk are following.
E se eu proposo, como você fala, a philosophy of religious experience, a sort of answer to Jean Nicole's clear-cut separation of philosophy and theology, and could we say that your intention is to turn the theological term upside down, instead of proposing that God's coming to phenomenology, as it is usually it's the usual way how to read the theological term, you seem to call theology to come to the world. Is there something like a theology of the world in your work, which would be the counter argument against the proponents of the theological term? All in all, do I read your argument correctly as a double critique? A critique of Jean Nicole's critique, as well as the critique of those whom Jean Nicole criticized. Second, I would like to pay attention to Falk's claim that, I quote now, today's task is to liberate theology by means of philosophy. Quote, that is by rigorous adherence to the human per se as the departure point of any further theological reflections. And this reminds me of another place in Jan Patočka, who despite his initial harsh evaluation of relations between philosophy and theology, reconsidered his position, and in the 50s he said, now I will quote in Lent, philosophy can certainly not be transformed into the voice of faith. Nevertheless, philosophy must be able to construct at its utmost boundaries the possibility of meaning which is not purely human and which transcends human understanding. For this possibility, philosophy must supply thoughts, frameworks, and categories, or it must show, at least, which ideas are insufficient for this task and why they cannot be pushed through. To return to the vocabulary used by Immanuel Falk, theology must start from below, with the possibility before actuality. Even theological claims are embedded in historical concreteness. And in this sense, theological thinking does not primarily focus on a positive content of something that is revealed, but tries to understand the movement of revealing that is being addressed, the moment of being addressed, even though the content of this movement can never be fully penetrated. Hence, theology liberated by philosophy does not escape history to the other world of transcendence. Rather, the matter at stake is the crossing of transcendence and immanence. Philosophy is thinking from below, that is immanent thinking, yet by no means indifferent to the transcendent aspect of the understanding of being. Theology in turn is thinking transcendence, yet always from a concrete situation incarnated in history. As a theologian, I find this approach appealing, especially in the context of post-Christendom age, where Christianity and its symbolic language cease to be the interpretative framework of the world. And my question to Professor Falk is thus, do you see the proposed liberation of theology by means of philosophy or phenomenology as a point of departure for theological thinking after the end of Christendom or Christianity as we used to know it? And despite your reluctance to present the main idea of crossing the Rubicon as a mere phenomenologization of theology, do you see some future in doing theology phenomenologically? And my last and also very brief note concerns the relation of Professor Falk's project to the work of Jean-Yves Lacoste, who was already mentioned here several times. In particular, I have in mind his essay entitled From Theology to Theological Thinking, in which Lacoste argues that philosophy and theology are united in pursuing one and the same task of thinking. This task could be translated as the vocation of the understanding of being, in which philosophy and theology are, according to Lacoste, united. Yeah, or in a very simplified version of Lacoste's argument, both philosophers and theologians feel home in the same library, surrounded by the same piles of books. Hence, why shall we or they pretend that are interested in different matters? Even in Professor Falk's book, One can read that the distinction between the god of philosophers and the god of faith is false, which implies that in some ways the differentiation of theology from philosophy is artificial too. Without presuming any answer, I wonder, what is the relation of the project of crossing the Rubicon to the concept of theological thinking developed by Jean-Yves Lacoste? And especially I am interested whether the idea of crossing is close to Lacoste's suggestion with regard to prudent abolishing of boundaries between theology and philosophy. So let me end where I have started, that is with the words of Jan Patočka. I quote, "The philosopher knows that he must eternally walk on earth." Nevertheless, Patočka adds to this, "But what is the earth? It might be that its peaks touch the stars. It might be that its abysses contain the deepest mystery." End quote. Thank you for your attention.
Thanks for your paper, which is, in my head, a very good one, because you understood exactly what I'm saying. So the question is not to know if you are saying what I'm saying, because you are exactly saying what I'm saying, so I have no question about that. But my question is your question, which are very difficult question and important question. First, I just want to say about the beginning of your paper, that you are speaking about the sketch debates here between philosophy and theology. And you say, in here, in this situation, in this university, in this country, so I don't know what does it mean, but it means something. And I think that when there are debates between faculties in the universities, when there are debates between universities, in a town or in a country, the best way to resolve the debate is to speak about the things themselves. As we are doing, you are from the Faculty of Theology, you are from the Faculty of Philosophy, and you have to speak about philosophy and theology. But when we are speaking about philosophy and theology, we are not speaking only about boundaries, but we're speaking about what are you doing exactly. As you said, I like this remark, when you said that both philosopher and theologian feel home in the same library, surrounded by the same piles of books. I think it's absolutely true. Absolutely true, even in France. So, it is a fact. Exactly what I say. Now, we don't have to ask themselves if there is a theological turn of phrase. There is one. But what does it mean? And what do we have to do together? Something like that, to speak. And you will see that if you do that during 3 years, 4 years after, the faculty will work together, just to say, it's obvious. So I think that I want to say that there is a question behind your remark, and your reference to Patočka is a very interesting one, because this remark that the philosopher knows that he must eternally walk on earth, it is exactly what I want to say, exactly what I said this morning. It means that I am Patočkin. Of course! The philosopher knows that he must eternally walk on earth. I don't know Patočka very well, I really. Yes, I completely agree. Now, if I am a Christian, what I have to do? That is a question. But the beginning is Patočka and the question, but what is the earth? And I think that is a good question. So, that is about the introduction of the question. Then, there are many questions in a few minutes. It's complicated. Huh? Give response. Just for some remarks. Your first group of questions is about philosophy of religion and philosophy of religious experience. Yes, I think. So is it an answer to Gianico? I'm not sure it is to Gianico, because Gianicos don't mind about philosophy of religion, in fact. But I think it is an answer to philosophers who are saying, I'm only studying philosophy of religion and nothing else. And they are saying, I am only a philosopher. And often in France, but I don't know how is it here, the people who said that they are only philosophers and they are studying only philosophy of religion are Christians, often. And paradoxically, the people who study theology are saying, I don't do theology anymore because I don't want to be a theologian. You can see that often in France, the philosophers who accept to cross the Rubicon are sometimes like, who said, I'm a philosopher, but I can be. So the question is, perhaps it is not a response to Gianico, but it is a response to a situation in France, but also in other countries. That is to say that it's not enough to speak about philosophy of religion, because religion is not an object. That is my conviction. I'm close from to Bultmann. Religion is not an object. Religion is a sort of adhesion, conviction, not more, decision. Okay. And if I'm speaking about religion only as an object, I can say I speak about religion, but I don't mind if you believe it. Okay, but I mind. Not for you, because you are to be, not because you are to be converted. Because for me, it is a topic of adhesion. So then you asked to me, many questions, that if I want to develop a theology to come to the world, yes, but. Many theologians are speaking like that, to come to the world, but what is the sense of the world? So, I will not say that I want to develop a theology to come to the world. You have to do it. I'm not a theologian. I don't want to develop a theology to come to the world. You see that? One of my points, which is very important in my work and in Crossing the Rubicon, is the fact that you have three steps. First, there is the world itself, then the transformation of the world by resurrection, and then if you are a Christian, you discover that you are in the world of God. It is a topic axiom of all Saint Balthasar when he's speaking about Bonaventure, and he said, and it is the principle of resolving of my problem between the two, he said, everything happens in human being, happens in God, except sin. It means if something happened in me, which is anguish, it's happening in God. If something happened in me, in my body, it's happening in God. So, the question is to transform what is happening in me, as human being, in God. So when you are speaking about the world, which world is it? Is it only the world of human being or the world of God? First, it is the world of human being and philosopher. If I become intelligent, it is the world of God. But I don't want to say that I want that God is coming back to the world. As it's conception in my So, a critique of Gianico's critic, as well as a critic of those whom Gianico's criticized. Exactly. It's absolutely true. It means that there is a Gianico's critic. And I said this morning that the tone is not the good one. But there is the people who criticize what Gianico's criticized. And I think that among the Catholic thinkers, even in France, nobody took in a serious way what Gianico said. So, And the same way, Pellico, criticize and that. So for me, I don't want to speak about the theological term, but I want to say how to speak after the theological term. Okay? Then the second part of questions, when you are speaking about the human per se, what I said in French, l'homme tout court, which is my thesis. Then you quote Patochka, I agree with him at that point too, of course. And you start from below. And then you spoke about the liberation of theology by philosophy. This conception of liberation of theology by philosophy is exactly the inverse of Orson Balthazar. Because Orson Balthazar wrote a text, I read it when I was studying theology, which is the liberation of philosophy by theology. So, I thought immediately, I don't understand why a theologian wants to liberate a philosophy, and liberate a philosophy by theology. In my way, it is because Balthazar is always in the way of philosophy of religion. But which is more close from Hegel. I think that Hegel is in philosophy of religion. Mean that, and that is the sense of Hegel attempt, which is a very important one. It is to say, we can study an object of theology and to know what is the philosophical sense of this object. Trinity and dialectic, incarnation, and so on. Okay? So me exactly, I spoke about the liberation of theology by philosophy. Is it a departure for theological thinking after the end of Christianity? First, I don't like to speak about the end of Christianity. Perhaps it's happened not. For me, the debate about modernity, post-modernity, and so on, for me, means nothing. Because it's absolutely a sociological debate about what's happened. Of course, if you are reading my work, Metamorphosis Finitude, you can see that I'm speaking about what we are living today. But I'm not saying it is the end of Christianity, and so on. It is the end of a form of Christianity, but not the end of Christianity. You have to remember what happened at the time of Augustine, when he wrote the City of God, in 40, 10. It was absolutely the end. And after, no more Christianity in Rome and so on. So the time was very catastrophic, more than today perhaps. So, I'm not sure that we are speaking about the end of Christianity, but if you are speaking of the end of Christianity, it is probably the beginning of something else. I'm against the catastrophic, or how you say that, discourse. And you have to read again the opening of the discourse of the Pope John 22, at the opening of the Council Vatican II. What he said, I hate the people, we are always speaking about catastrophe, and the people, he said, Paul, I hate the people, we are always saying that the time were always better before. And he used an expression, which is the prophet of, the prophet de malheur, prophet of, and it is exactly the same one in Nietzsche. So, it was a pop talk. It means that perhaps our time is not the baddest one. I just heard at the radio 2 days ago that during those last 10 years, there is half the children who die are half percent than before. In the world. You understand?
Yeah.
Le nombre d'enfants qui sont morts, le nombre d'enfants qui sont morts dans le monde a baissé de 50% en 10 ans. Le nombre d'enfants qui sont morts, the number of children died, is a baissé of 50% in 10 years. So, it's a progress for the humanity. So we can't say that everything is, we say that, and because I'm not saying that everything is good, but I'm saying that God loves our words, and we can't begin by the author. Okay. So then, the last part of question about joint letters. Ah, so very good to ask me a question. I know him very well. If you are going to Paris, you have to take a cup of tea with Charlie in his apartment. So, Jai will be speaking about liturgy, but if you are going to the mass with Jai, absolutely not liturgy like that. Huh? One of my students follow one of my course on Macos, liturgy, so I will go to the mass to see Jai Macos, and then you go to the mass, he's like that. Sleeping. And he says that liturgy is not in church. You know that liturgy is everywhere. So it's not a liturgy. One of my students, she's in PhD, she's a sister. She's doing a PhD with me about liturgy and phenomenology. But for her, liturgy is the church. That's good because she's a sister. But I said, it's not Lacoste. Then I'm very close from Lacoste. Probably he is the one which is too close. Because the beginning of Lacoste is also a part of finitude. The difference between Lacoste and me, and I wrote it in the book which is Le Combat Amoureux, the Love and Struggle, about phenology and theology in French phenology. It will be published in 6 months in the US, it has been translated. And I explained that because you have a chapter on Lacoste, a chapter on Marion, a chapter on Henri, a chapter on Chrétien, and so on Derrida, on Marcin, on Merleau-Ponty. And I explained that the difference between Lacoste and me is the fact that for Lacoste, something changes when we are coram deo. It means that for Lacoste, that is exactly the same for Marion, exactly the same for Chrétien, and so on. When God's coming, it broke everything. And my thinking is not that God broke the world by revelation, but he transformed it. And that is the difference. That's why with his sister who is doing his PhD with me, she wrote on my books and she said, for Frank is cum deo, he is not coram deo. And my name, Emmanuel, means with God. And it's not the same to be with God and to be in front of God. Because when you are in front of God, God is breaking, it's breaking. But when you are with God, you've got nothing but you have to change yourself. So it's not the same. So, then you speak about this book, From Theology to the Theological Thinking. I have this book, he gave it to me. It's a book not translated in French. Why? It doesn't want. Because in fact it's a course he gave in Virginia. It is just not. And he knows that if he publishes that in France, he will not have a good reception of this book. Perhaps first because it is not enough wrote. You see, you read. But the second reason that is, I think it's not so easy for Jean Lacoste to say what he said in Virginia to say it in France. Exactly, there is a very good book under the direction of Chris Hackett and Tarek Dika. You know it? The Quiet Power is Possible. And you have interview of French phenomenologists, Marion, Chrétien, Romano, me, and so on. But what I said, I will never say it in France. So, or, and it's the same for all. If you want to know what we are thinking, really, you have to think about that book. Because, in fact, well, of course, because you are saying, you are not speaking to your colleagues. You are speaking outside. I explained that you have first generation Levinas, and then the second generation, and then I am Merleau-Ponty. But I don't want to write in France. You have Marion, and then there is me. What does it mean in France? But when you're outside, you understand. So I finished just to say that ensure that I don't want to abolish the Bowling Barrier. Even when you spoke this morning about the synthesis, and you use the term twice, of synthesis at the beginning of the text, and even of the synthesis, because I don't agree with this term. Because when we are speaking about synthesis in French, it means that it is a sort of reunification between the two fields, or it is a sort of, as in dialectic, Hegelian dialectic, as if there was a peace at the end between philosophy and theory. There is no peace. But it is a false conception to think that life is peace. Life is not peace first. Life is to experience of difference. Even in God in Trinity, I think Gregorius is a manner of experience. Even in the combat between Jacob and the angel. So, I don't want to find a peace between physical theology, discipline, and everything. That is a false dream. But I just want to say that if we are in combat, we are in the true place. Not because the combat is a war, but because the combat is a manner to experience myself. That's why I explain that in a loving struggle, that the struggle is not polymos, a war, but an agon, opposition of the contrary. So, no abolition of boundaries, no synthesis for me, but a visit. If I am intelligent, I go and I visit my colleagues and say, okay, you are working on Balthazar about salvation. Okay, what I'm speaking about? Ah, Saint Augustine. And you come, you are interested. Okay, you are a phenomenologist. You are speaking about physics. Okay, I'm interested. So we have to do the two sets. And I finish just to say that the philosophy is not a sort of propedeutic to theology, and that is a problem often for the theology. It means that what's happening in medieval philosophy, even in Thomas Aquinas, who said, okay, the philosophy is a servant of theology, it means that I need philosophical concepts to study theology. So perhaps you say to your colleagues, okay, we have students in theology, and they have to follow a course in philosophy because the Pope was here or something. Okay. So they are going in philosophy. But you have to teach what is a substance. Why? Because I will speak about transubstantiation. And if they don't know what is substance, they will not understand what is transubstantiation. So you have to do the work. So the work of theology of philosopher is to give means to give. No, that is not. So. And then, so we can't say that philosophy prepares theology. That is not true. The theology is not the end of philosophy. The philosophy has got an autonomy in itself. Okay, but the schema of transformation, of metamorphosis, which is the schema of resurrection for me is also the schema of transformation of philosophy by theology. Transformation and not subalternation. Okay. But philosophy has not to be obliged to transform.